I think one of the challenges about how to sequence the whether you're doing justice or peace first is also the fact that some victims will not be there in a while, or some victims may be ready to speak as the conflict is going on, and as the conflict moves to a different direction, you may not be able to capture what those victims want and what they need to be seen done. But of course, clearly, I think from the conference, one of the things that was clear is that when we're talking about peace, you can talk about cessation of conflict, and therefore that means that at that point in time you are only talking about stopping the conflict and moving on politically. But that doesn't mean that then you do not address the issues that were the factors that led to the conflict. And I think for me that is important. Of course, it's not easy to pick people up when the conflict is going on to go and try them, because they are not even amenable to that. So I think that, yes, there's need to be some sequencing, but there's also need to be very, very sensitive to the fact that victims also need to see that something is being done, even as you're talking about peace. Those who are suffering violations, what happens to them? Who is capturing their story, and what promise do they have that those issues will be addressed in the future, even if you're not addressing them immediately? I think that, of course, is the greatest challenge for Africa, the fact that we cannot separate the politicians, the political elite, from all the violations that are happening in Africa. I think, of course, from the conference, it's clear that there's some progress, but the progress is colored by the fact that people want to protect themselves, and I believe that is understandable. And for me, I think that is why it's so important to link the African mechanisms, the national mechanisms, and the international mechanisms. Because if Africa is not willing to hold the leaders accountable, then clearly we still need the international justice system. And I think for me that is important, that the international justice mechanism will still have to focus on Africa. So as long as they are not willing to come up with mechanisms that will hold them accountable as they are in office, or even after they've left office, then there's no other option. Yes, I think that is true, because if you speak to the Africans on the ground, the common citizens who are actually victims of violations or victims of conflict, they don't care where the solutions come from. They just want the solutions to be there. And a lot of them have despaired against their own national systems. So I don't think that those Africans will care whether the solutions are brought by somebody from the West or they are brought from somebody from Africa. I believe they would be very happy if the solution were from the national jurisdiction, because they vote in government and they expect that those governments will actually ensure this rule of law, that everybody is held accountable. So for me, I think that it is true that a lot of these issues that are being discussed at the international level by the African leaders, it's about themselves. It's not about the citizens who stand to gain from these processes. So I do believe, I agree with the sentiment that a lot of those views are not views of the ordinary citizen in Africa who is suffering, and really who doesn't care. If you look at humanitarian response in Africa, where does it come from? It comes from the West. And, African citizens don't reject it on that basis. So I believe in the same vein, they would accept whoever comes in to redress their situation. I think when we are talking about the ICC and beyond, I think it's for us as Africans to ask ourselves that we are very unhappy about the fact that the international community has to intervene in our conflict situations, has to intervene through judicial processes. So for me, beyond means, as Africans, what is it, what can we do at the national level? Because I think the perfect justice mechanisms are those that work at the national level. If you look at Europe now, man, Sarkozy is on trial for things that he did, some of them while in office. Berlusconi is on trial. And I think for Africans, I think that is what we long for, that even if somebody cannot be held accountable now while they are in office, that in future the same national systems will hold them accountable. So I think for me, when I think of beyond, I think that, yeah, our beyond should be building our national institutions, building the regional institutions, but also being able in future as Africans to say, look, we as Africans are passing a resolution on Syria that they must be held accountable at the ICC. And I think that is what we will be doing, playing our role at the international level to hold other people accountable. Yeah, I think Kenya has actually come from very far. And comparatively, I think the legal system in Kenya is quite strong if we compare it to other legal systems. I think one of the issues that we've discussed here, that is true in every country, is the relationship between the justice system and the political system. And it's of course also very clear that often, even when we talk about the three arms of government, that the judicial arm is always the weaker arm. That is what I believe, because they don't have the raw power to implement the things that they want. So I think that struggle will continue, but I'm happy to say that in Kenya right now, I mean, people can go and challenge actions of the state, of the president, of various agencies in court. The results are mixed, but at the end of the day, the fact that people do go to court and sometimes they do get good decisions, and that therefore, in a sense, they are holding the state accountable at the national level, is something that to me is very progressive. We've had the former president being sued by private citizens, and he has had to go and respond in court. The immediate former president has taken the stand in court to give evidence in a civil suit, but still, just the fact that that can happen in Kenya, I think it's a good signal. We are not yet there, but I think we are getting there. I think, yes, the land issue in Kenya is very, if you look at our constitution, we actually, the 2010 constitution, one of the things that we really tried to do was to address the land issue and the historical injustices around the land issue. But in practice, what has been happening is that we are still seeing those tensions. We created a land commission, but then the state, the executive still wants to have a lot of control on land management, on land allocation, on all these things that we have in the past said we do not want the executive to deal with. So, but I think the fact that we have a normative framework is so important because the state is also trying, the executive has been trying to make sure that we have a proper land registry so that in terms of who owns what, it becomes clearer. And for Kenyans trying to litigate, to access their land rights, I think that is a good thing. But we are not yet there in terms of historical injustices on the land issue. In terms of the other resources that we are discovering, I think again, the constitutional framework is strong on how we manage those resources. The implementation is a serious challenge because again, I think the political elite always want to control natural resources, either directly or indirectly. And so of course the choices we make, mistake of who is managing in terms of foreign investors, who is in charge of managing our natural resources remains a problem. And I think we have to come to the point where as Kenyans or as Africans, it doesn't matter which foreign investor we invite into our countries, we must be in charge, because it is our resources, and those are investors interested in their own countries making a kill out of our resources. So how do we ensure that the kill is for our citizens, it's not for other citizens? I think the universities in Kenya, we have very many universities now. I think one of the greatest challenges is the challenge of resource, of just what is it that is available. And of course, the other thing is the interest in research and using research outcomes to impact on change. And I think that is one of the serious challenges. And how do we link universities to the knowledge that is available? So for example, we have CODESIA that is doing great work in terms of research. Does that research go back to the universities so that when we are teaching in our classes, we are not teaching from a theoretical perspective?
Fiesa aqui.